In this screencast, we'll examine how we can utilize a Routh array to determine whether or not a process, whether controlled or uncontrolled, is stable or unstable. And in order to do this, we have to recall what dictates stability in a process from a mathematical standpoint. So whether or not this is just a simple process transfer function of an input over an output and transfer function form, or if it's from a controlled standpoint where we have how the set point affects the output or controlled variable, or how some disturbance variable affects the output or controlled variable, what we're going to end up here with is a transfer function which has some numerator over some denominator. The issue of stability is handled solely in the denominator. Most importantly, for a stability, if all of the roots are negative, that means that the process is stable. On the other hand, if at least one root is positive, that means that the denominator, that the process is unstable. We're going to focus more on controlled processes using a basic feedback control loop. In these feedback control loops, whether it be due to a disturbance change or a set point change, the denominator can be expressed for a generic feedback loop as 1 plus the open loop gain, which can be expanded to 1 plus the transfer functions for the controller, the valve, the process, and the transmitter. When we set this equal to 0, this represents the characteristic equation. All we need to analyze the stability of a process is its characteristic equation. In other words, 1 plus the open loop gain. So in our Routh array analysis, we're going to assume that our characteristic equation has the form shown on the screen, where n represents the highest power of s in the equation. And you keep on counting down until you reach the first order s term and then the term of the constant, with a sub n representing the coefficient of the corresponding power. So for a process to be stable, the first criteria is that all coefficients, in other words, everything from a0 to an, must be greater than or equal to 0. The second criterion, both must occur for this to happen. One of these is not enough. All the values in the first column of the Routh array must be positive. So below, on the screen, the bottom left, shows you what a Routh array looks like. When we're talking about the first column, this is the column where all the values must be positive. Most of the values in this Routh array will be zero. We only generally focus on a very small subset of the Routh array. You'll notice that the first two rows are A's. These A's are the corresponding coefficients in the characteristic equation. You start with the value that comes in front of the largest power of s, and you work in this up-down zigzag formation going to a1 to an minus 1, going in this type of fashion, until you run out of values. For the remaining values, they will all be found by using equations which are connected to the use of determinants and discriminants and stuff along those lines from linear algebra. But these are all just equations. So in this case, we would use these equations in order to find our values. If our coefficients aren't present, so for example, if we have a fourth order transfer function in the denominator, in other words, a fourth order characteristic equation, we would only use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of these values. So therefore, it would cause a number of these values to be 0. So with all of this information, let us go back to attempting to solve the problem. So if we look at part A, what we can immediately see is without doing any of the Routh array analysis, we see that we have a negative value for one of our coefficients. So therefore, that automatically means that our process is unstable without doing any other calculations. For part B, we see the fact that they're all positive, so therefore it passes the first test of a Routh array. Now it has to pass the second test, where the first column is all positive. We start with our values and we realize that our highest power is 4, so an will be 1. And then we keep on going down to an minus 1, which is 2. Remember that in this case here, the value of n is 4. So an minus 2 would be 4. An minus 3 would be 5. An minus 4 would be 1. And the rest of these terms would be 0. So what we can now do is evaluate B1. So with B1, what we have here is an minus 1 term, which if we go to our Routh array is 2. We have our an minus 2 term, which is 4, subtracted from our an term, which is 1, and our an minus 3 term, which is 5. And we'll divide this by our an minus 1 term, which is 2. So therefore, B1 would equal 3/2. We can then do a very similar thing to solve for B2. B2 is just the an minus 4 term, which is just 1. B3 is going to be 0. The reason why is because it would be asking for the n minus 6 and n minus 7 terms, which would be here, which we know are 0. So therefore, we know that B3 is going to be 0. We can use our equation to solve for C1, and C1 would be 11 over 3. Once again, we would have a 0 here. Looking at C2, we know the fact that B3 is going to be 0, which means that this term is going to be 0. So this just reduces to the an minus 5 term, which also happens to be 0. So therefore, we have a front of zeros where that means that the value here would also be 0. So there's no need to calculate it. So if we look down our first column, we see that all of the values are positive. This process is stable. So in this screencast, we showed how we can use a Routh array to determine the stability of a process which is being controlled. Again, as a note, it can also be used to assess uncontrolled processes, but typically Routh arrays are done to analyze processes which have some sort of control to them.